So, dear students, very good morning to all of you, and I welcome you all into the Industrial Pharmacy 1. Started the liquid orals, isn't it? Now, what are the liquid orals? These are the liquid dosage forms which are to be taken by the oral route. Now, while studying this, we had gone through already the classification, the introduction. Then we saw what are the emulsion, what are the suspensions, what are the different liquid formulations. These are used into the body cavity. These are used into the body surfaces. We saw the definition, we saw the advantages, disadvantages of the liquid oral, the classification of the solutions, how the solutions these are going to be formed, what are their terminologies, what are the selection criteria for the solutes, then the different methods of enhancement of the solubility, then we saw the selection of the salt, we saw the pH scale, we saw the use of co-solvent, we saw the different methods of preparation of the solutions. And we saw the stability of the solutions, its concerns. In detail, we had gone through the syrup, what is the classification of the syrup, advantages of the syrup, disadvantages of the syrup, the components of the syrup. Then how to go for preparation, how to go for formation of the syrups, that is by heating, that is by adding the liquid medicament, and by the percolation, the packagings associated with the process of syrups, the process involved in the packaging of the syrups, the storage of the syrup, and last but not the least, the labelings of the syrups. Now, dear student, today we will going through the another liquid oral formulation, which is said to be the elixir. And if time permit, we will go for the emulsion and its details. That is, what are the emulsion, what are their definitions, then what will be the advantages, disadvantages, what will be the identification test, what are the different types of emulsions, like say the micro emulsion, macro emulsion, and the nano emulsion. So all these details we will try to cover in our today's lecture. But before directly going to the emulsions, let us go through the elixir, that what elixirs are. Elixirs, these are the clear sweetened hydroalcoholic solutions. Alcoholic content that may vary from 10%, 12% up to 14%. So what these are? These are the hydroalcoholic. That means they will contain water as well as they will contain the alcohol. And the alcohol content that will range from minimum 10% to maximum 40%. These are intended for the oral use, no doubt. We are studying the liquid oral. That means all these has to be taken by the oral route. These are flavored. The elixirs, these are flavored one. For what purpose? Because the flavoring that will enhance their palatability. They will enhance their consumability. Usually these are less sweet than the syrups and the less viscous. Why these are less sweet? Because the syrups, these are the concentrated saturated solutions of the sugars, but the elixir, these are not the concentrated and saturated solutions of the sugar. That's why these are less sweet than that of the syrup, and therefore these are also less viscous. Now the elixir, these are going to be classified as the medicated elixirs. Now you can see here the list of the medicated elixir. Medicated elixir, these are the elixir which are going to be used in case of the therapeutic usefulness, for their therapeutic usefulness, in order to treat certain kinds of the disorders. They will contain the active pharmaceutical ingredient, they will contain the active medicinal substance. So in case of the allergic disorders, like say the antihistaminic elixirs has to be given, which will contain the diphenhydramine. In case of pain condition, the analgesic elixirs are given, which will contain the acetaminophen. The elixirs, these are given in case of the heart disorders, cardiac disorders, like say the cardiotonic elixir. For example, the digoxin is the active constituent. In case of the pain condition, in case of the spasmodic conditions, in case of the muscle spasm condition, the hyoscyamine sulfate, that is to be given as an antispasmodic elixir. In case of sleep disorders, in case of the anxiety, the sedatives like say the phenobarbital, these are to be given, like say in case of convulsions, the phenobarbital elixir, that is the sedative elixir. And these all are the medicated elixirs. So these are used for their therapeutic effect. These are used for their therapeutic properties. There are non-medicated elixirs. Now, what these non-medicated elixirs are, they will not contain the active pharmaceutical ingredient. They will not contain the pharmaceutical substance. They do not contain any therapeutic agent and can be used for the dilution of an existing medicated elixir. So non-medicated elixir, as they will not contain the therapeutic ingredient, active pharmaceutical ingredient, so these are used for the process of giving, for the process of diluting the medicated elixir. These only contain water, alcohol, sweetening agent, and coloring agent. Most common non-medicated elixirs, these are the following one, like say the aromatic elixirs, perfumes, compound benzaldehyde elixirs, and the isoalcoholic elixir. They will not containing the therapeutic agent. They will not containing the active pharmaceutical ingredient. They will simply contain the water, alcohol, sweetening agent, and if necessary, the flavoring agent. So these are the medicated and non-medicated elixirs. Now let us see that what are the advantages of the elixirs. Why these are designed, why these are developed as a dosage form. They might be having certain their effects. They might be having their certain merits and the advantages. So these are better able to maintain both water soluble and the alcohol soluble components into the solution. Let's say, for example, if the active pharmaceutical ingredient, that is soluble, then we cannot go for preparation of the solution. Then we will be having the option of the elixir, because the elixir will contain alcohol as well as water. So we can go for dissolving the active pharmaceutical ingredient, which is insoluble in water, into the alcohol, and water is soluble in alcohol. So then the water that is going to be added, that is going to be mixed in order to form the elixir. It has a stable characteristics. The elixir that will offer this stable characteristic, it is easily prepared by simple solution. Just dissolving the active pharmaceutical ingredient into the particular solvent, either it may be aqueous or non-aqueous, either it may be water or alcohol, just to go on dissolving into the suitable solvent and mix the other ingredients, so that we will go for preparation of a elixir. What will be the disadvantages? The less effective than the syrups in masking the taste of the medicated substances. The syrup that will contain the larger proportion, the saturated sugar solution, so it will contain more sugar, and because of that, the taste, the obnoxious taste or the bitter taste or the acrid taste of the active pharmaceutical ingredient, that can be masked suitably by giving the syrup. But as the concentration of this sugar, that is less in case of syrup, so these are not suitable to mask the taste of the active pharmaceutical ingredient, that might be bitter or acrid. So they will contain alcohol that will accentuate the saline taste of the bromide. So bromide, that can be given suitably with the help of the elixirs, as they will contain the alcohol. Now, what will be the components of the alcohol? As already we saw, the purified water. Water, that is the most important component along with the alcohol. And major component is the water, is the purified water. And minor component, that is the alcohol. So alcohol, that is minimum in the 10% and maximum up to 40%. This is employed Alcohol is employed as a co-solvent to ensure solubility of all ingredients. That means if these solutes, these are not soluble in aqueous or in case of water, these can be suitably solubilized in case of the alcohols. Generally, the concentration of alcohol is greater than 10%. As I said, that lowest or the minimum concentration of alcohol, that will be 10%. So generally, the concentration of alcohol is greater than 10%. That means more than 10% volume by volume. However, in some preparations, the concentration of alcohol may be greater than 40% or up to 40%, right? So the highest concentration, that might be 40%, or sometime if necessary, that will be more than 40%. Polyol co-solvents. The elixir that will contain the polyol co-solvents, like say the propylene glycol, glycerol. The propyl or the polyol co-solvent, these may be employed to enhance the solubility of the therapeutic agent and associated excipients. There is a need to add the sweetening agent. The less concentration is required as compared to the syrups. So there is need to add the flavors and the colors. Based on the color, one can go for choosing the flavor. Based on the flavor, one can go for choosing the colors. Flavors and colors are added to increase the palatability and enhance the aesthetic qualities of the formulations. Flavors, they will enhance the palatability. Colors, they will improve the aesthetic property, that is look properties, isn't it? You can see, we can go for use of the various kinds of the flavors, like say the ice cream flavor or chili flavor, or say the tomato flavors. And we can go for using the colors, like say the green color, orange color, and the red colors. Elixirs, they will contain the preservatives. Elixirs containing more than 10 to 12% of the alcohol are usually self-preserving, because alcohol itself acts as a preserving agent. So those that will contain less than that of the 12% or 10%, in that case, there is need to add the preservatives and do not require the addition of an antimicrobial agent. Otherwise, parabens and the benzoates, methyl paraben, propyl parabens, these are going to be added in such elixirs which will contain less percentage of the alcohol, either less than that of the 12% or within the 10 to 12%. What will be the method of preparation of the elixirs? It is very simple. Just dissolve the water-soluble ingredients into the water, add sucrose and other ingredients in the alcohol, that is 5 to 40%. The aqueous solution is then added to the alcoholic solution with constant stirring. Elixirs should be brilliantly clear and therefore strained or filtered if necessary, subjected to clarifying action of purified chalk or siliceous earth. Generally, the elixirs, these are clear one, but if they will contain some impurities, that can be cleared with the help of the process of the filtration. Packaging of the elixirs. You can see there is a mood elixir, that is Cureveda, and there is a Bronchicum, that is the elixir which is going to be used as the in order to treat the cough condition. Elixir should be packed in glass or plastic containers as selected based on the requirement. Due to the volatile nature of some of the components of elixir, because of the presence of high percentage of alcohol, alcohol is highly volatile, elixir should be packaged in tight containers and not stored at high temperature. So there is a need to indicate the storage conditions. It should not be stored at high temperature, because at high temperature, the volatile component that may get volatilized. So in summary, if we see what we saw up till now, we had gone through the introduction of the liquid orals, the classification of the liquid orals, the definition of the liquid orals. Then we saw the merits, demerits, and different types of the solutions. We saw the different methods to enhance the solubility. We saw the methods of preparation of the solution, stability of the solutions, Then we saw the details of this syrup, its definition, components of this syrup, the method of preparation of this syrup. And last but not the least, just now we saw the elixir, components of elixir, methods of preparation of elixirs, and packaging and storage of the elixirs. So all these are the things that we saw up till now as far as the liquid orals are concerned with the syrups and the elixirs. Now let's move to the next topic, that is the emulsions. Now in this particularly, what we have to study, or after studying the coming details, the coming slides, you should able to understand the introduction of the emulsion. You should able to explain what are its different types, what are the uses, the different theories of the emulsification, and the different tests that are used for the process of identification of the emulsions. Now, in order to understand all these things, we have to go through the introduction, definition as far as the IP and USP is concerned, the classification of the emulsions, like say the OW type of emulsion, WO type of emulsion, and micro emulsion, some of the aspects of the macro emulsion and nano emulsion. We will see the advantages and disadvantages of the emulsions. We will see the uses, that is the oral uses, systemic uses, local uses, and other uses, or the other routes by which the emulsions, these are to be introduced into the body. Then we will see the test for identification and the different theories of the emulsification. Now, if you see the introductory details, what the emulsions are? Emulsions, these are the biphasic liquid dosage forms. Biphasic, that means it will contain the two different types of the phases. They will contain the two different liquid phases. Bi, two, liquid, both are the liquid phases. And these two liquid phases are immiscible with each other. Like, let us say, for example, oil and water. Now, when these are the immiscible with each other, then how it will going to be stabilized? These are going to be stabilized with the help of addition of a third agent, which is said to be the emulgent or emulsifying agent. These are the heterogeneous preparations. These are also known as the dispersed system. Why these are said as heterogeneous preparation? Because they will contain the two different liquid phases. And why these are said to be the dispersed phase? Because the one phase that is going to be dispersed into the other phase. That means one phase that will remain into the dispersed phase, another phase that will remain into the continuous phase. The phase which is into the distributed phase, that is said to be the dispersed phase. So these are thermodynamically unstable. So that means when the temperature that is getting increased at that time, that will lead to the separation, that is said to be the phase separation phenomenon. What these emulsions, you can see the emulsions are the colloidal dispersions of one liquid. Now that liquid is said to be the dispersed phase into the another liquid, that another liquid is said to be the continuous phase. The liquid which is going to be added, these droplets of the oil, these are the dispersed phase, whereas this continuous phase, that is the aqueous phase or the water phase. Now if you see why it is said to be the colloidal, because of the presence of the particle size, that is the particle size of the dispersed phase that will remain in the range of 0.1 to 100 micrometer. That means the droplets, these are distributed in the range of 0.1 micrometer to 100 micrometer. There is a presence of small droplets of one liquid that are spread throughout the other liquid. Now, if you will see the definition that is given by the IP in 2010, oral emulsions, these are what? These are the oral liquids containing one or more active ingredients. They will contain either one active ingredient or more than one active ingredient. These are stabilized oil in water dispersions, either or both phases of which may contain dissolved solids. This will contain water which will containing the solute. This may also contain oil which will contain the solute, and these solutes are nothing but the active pharmaceutical ingredients APIs. Solids may also be suspended in oral emulsions. The emulsion which is to be taken by oral route, that may also contain the solid substances, the powder substances, which cannot be given by the other dosage form, like say the suspension, that is predominantly the solid biphasic liquid dosage form. Emulsions, they may exhibit phase separation but are easily reformed on shaking. So upon storage, the emulsion that will possess the capability to go on separating different phases, but once we will go for shaking it, that's why it has been always written onto the emulsions, that is shake well before use, always we are when we are going for the dosing, because it is in kept into the shelf and there it will go for separation. So once we will go for shaking, so that will get easily mixed with each other. As far as the definition which is given by USP is concerned, USP 29, the emulsions, these are the two-phase systems in which one liquid is dispersed throughout the another liquid in the form of the small droplet. If oil is dispersed phase and an aqueous solution is the continuous phase, the system is designated as an oil in water emulsion. Contrary to this, if water or an aqueous solution is the dispersed phase and oil or oleaginous substances is in the continuous phase, the system is designated as a water in oil emulsion. So there is a OW type of emulsion when oil is distributed into the water, and there is a water in oil type of emulsion when water is distributed into the oil phase or into the oil continuous phase. You can see the emulsions, these are stabilized by emulsifying agent that prevent the coalescence. So this is the particular emulsion in which the oil droplet, these are going to be stabilized with the help of addition of the emulsifying agent. The emulsifying agent or the emulgent, these are most of the time surfactants. So how these surfactants they will act? The surfactants, these are used to stabilize emulsion by providing a physical barrier around the particle to coalesce. Now coalescence, that is the process of coming together, of uniting together. Now the surfactant, what they will do, they will surround these dispersed phase particle with the help of formation of a layer surrounding to that one, so that the coalescence that will not occur, so that the union that will not occur, and that's why that will be kept into the separated as a separate entity. Surfactants also reduce the interfacial tension between the phases, thus increasing the ease of emulsification upon mixing. The interfacial tension between the two different phases, like say this is the one phase, this is the another phase, this is the distributed phase, this is the continuous phase. So the surface tension between these two phases, that can be reduced so that they will remain miscible with each other. Now the pharmaceutical emulsions that may remain in the range from low viscosity to that of the high viscosity. So the emulsions with the low viscosity, these are said to be the lotions, and the emulsions with the high viscosity, these are said to be the creams. And based on the sizes, there are various types of the emulsion, like say the macro emulsion, micro emulsion, and the nano emulsion. Now if we see the differences between these two, what the macro emulsion, nano emulsion, and the micro emulsion, if we see the size range, in case of macro emulsions, the size range of the distributed particles, that is between 1 to 100 micrometer, or sometime between 10 to 50 micrometer ideally if we see. Whereas if we see the micro emulsion, in case of micro emulsion, the size range that will remain in the range of 10 to 100 nanometers. And in case of nano emulsions, the size range that will remain between the 20 to 500 nanometer. So these size globules, globule sizes that will make the clear distinction between macroemulsion, microemulsion, and nanoemulsion. The order will be like this: macroemulsion, microemulsion, and the nanoemulsion. Nanoemulsion, they will contain the very small size of the particles. Now, next, let us move to the theories of the emulsification. Now, already we saw that the process of emulsification that can be carried out by reducing the process of coalescence and by reducing the interfacial tension between the two different phases. The coalescence that can be prevented in the same phase, that is in the distributed phase, whereas the interfacial tension reduction that will occur between the two different immiscible phases, that is dispersed phase and the continuous phase. However, there are three different theories which will explain the process of emulsification, that is said to be the viscosity theory, wedge theory, and the film theory, or film theory that is also called as the adsorption theory. Now, film theory, which is also called as adsorption theory, what it is? The added emulsifying agent that will forms a mechanical film by adsorption at the interface of the liquid and offers stability to the emulsion. So that is the adsorption theory, that is the film theory. There is a formation of a thin film at the interface of between the two immiscible liquids. Viscosity theory, what it will indicates? The viscosity theory that will increase the viscosity of an emulsion will lead to an increase in the stability. So because of the increase into the viscosity, the coalescence of the particle or mixing of the two different phases, that will be minimized. Wedge theory, by successful accommodation of the soap molecule, one can decide the type of emulsion to be formulated. So we can go for use of the soap molecules, we can go for use of the soap solutions in case of the wedge theory. Types of emulsions. There are different types of emulsions, like see the OW type of emulsion, which is said to be the oil in water, and WO type of emulsion, which is said to be the water in oil type of emulsion. In addition, based on the globule size, there are micro emulsions, multiple emulsions, and the nano emulsions and the macro emulsions. Multiple emulsion, these are nothing but the OWO type of emulsion. That means oil in water and OWO, oil in water in oil, or WOW, that means water in oil in water type of emulsion. These are said to be the multiple emulsions. What is the oil in water emulsion? The oil droplets are dispersed throughout the aqueous phase, that is the OW type of emulsion. The fats and oils, these are to be given for oral administration, either as a medicament in their own right or as a vehicle for oil soluble drugs. Sometimes the oil themselves, they will going to be used as a active ingredient, like say the castor oil, which is to be given in the form of the emulsion in case of the constipation condition. And sometimes these oil, they will going to be used as a vehicle in which the active pharmaceutical ingredient that is going to be dissolved, which is difficult to dissolve into the aqueous phase, or which is difficult to be dissolved into the continuous phase. So oils, they will act as a vehicles for oil soluble drugs. These are always formulated as a oil in water emulsions. Water soluble drugs, these are more quickly released from the oil in water emulsions. Oil in water emulsion that will give a positive conductivity test as a water, because the water that will remains into the continuous phase, and water is the good conductor of electricity. The external phase is a good conductor of electricity. So this will test will be used in order to identify the emulsion, whether it is OW type of emulsion or WO type of emulsion. Water in oil type of emulsion, it is a system in which water is dispersed as globules in the oil, and oil is in the continuous phase. That is termed as a water in oil type of emulsion. So this will not give the conductivity. They are greasy and not water washable, whereas oil in water type of emulsion, these are non-greasy. These can be applied externally and these can be removed quickly, easily from the skin surface. Whereas water in oil type of emulsion, these are greasy, so these are difficult to remove with the help of the water. They are greasy and not water washable and are used externally to prevent evaporation of the moisture from the surface of the cream, surface of the oil, surface of the skin. And the example is the cold cream. Cold cream that is going to be applied externally onto the skin, and that will prevent the loss of moisture from that of the skin. So oil soluble drugs, these are more quickly released from that of the OW type of emulsion, because oil that will remains into the continuous phase, into the continuous phase, whereas the water that will remains into the dispersed phase. These are preferred for formulation meant for the external use, like say the creams. Micro emulsions. Now if you see here the emulsion, micro emulsion and the nano emulsion. As we will move from the emulsion to that of the micro to nano, because of the reduction into the globule size, you can see these are more transparent as we will move from the emulsion to micro to nano. Because in case of nano, the particle size is very, very small. That's why the nano emulsion, these are very clear solutions. Whereas the emulsion,